Good morning. That's that on button. That's right. Good morning, y'all. It's good to be here with you today. I look forward to what God's going to do. Let me make a couple quick announcements. Next week is daylight savings time. That means we spring forward. You lose the hour, okay? So go to bed early, all right? So don't forget that. We'd love to have that. March 12th is Chicken Foot. You want to come play some Chicken Foot with our senior adults? You can. And then March 16th at 8 o'clock is men's prayer breakfast. Those are so awesome just to pray together with men and be able to have a word spoken over us. And it's just great. Youth Winter Jam is March 17th. Super Senior Get Together is March 19th. You see it in the bulletins. Hey, March 24th, we're going to have the Lord's Supper. I always look forward to that. And also for Easter, we plan on doing our sunrise service in our new building. So I just want to super excited about that. We won't be quite finished with it, but we're moving forward with that. So that's going to be a great time. But also, don't forget about the couple key things. One is Lead Me, our marriage conference, April the 19th and 20th. So Friday night and Saturday. Man, sign up for that. I know that's going to change a lot of people's lives. Please be here if you can. It's going to be awesome. It sure can. And so we're super excited about what God's doing. Looking forward to what God's going to do today. Cody's at work, so I told him I would do the announcements. So what I really want to do more than anything is just tell you how grateful I am that you're here. And also just to hope and pray, as I've done this morning, that God would move miraculously on your heart and mine as well. And look forward to that. So if you would just stand with this morning, we're going to get this thing kicked off right with prayer. And we'll ask Brother David to come and just lead us in worship. So we're super excited about that. So turn to somebody and say, just sing it out. All right. I wanted to say that because it don't matter how good you can sing, just sing it out. Amen, David?
Amen.
So I want to do that. So let's pray. Father, we love you so much and we look forward to what you're going to do today. God, it is amazing to see a great crowd today, but Lord, it's also amazing the opportunity we have to come before a holy God who loves us so much that he gave his son for us, to worship you, Father, in spirit and truth. To Lord, just to put all other things aside, God. Our minds always run rampant with so many things, Father. Maybe just have a clear mind today and focus completely and utterly upon you, Jesus, and all that you've done for us. And may we give you glory, honor, and praise, Father. But also, Lord, may your Holy Spirit fill this place. And just, Lord, and may there be power here today in music and in message. And Father, may your Holy Spirit convict our hearts of sin. And Father, if there's anybody here that doesn't know you, may today be the day of salvation. If someone needs to join a church, may today be a day they join the church, God, and just be a part of the body of Christ, Lord God. And today, the bride of Christ, Lord, that we're building here, Lord, you're building here through us. And God, we're also grateful. We've heard some great news about the water stuff, Father. We're finally past all that. Praise God for that. Praise your name, your holy name for that. That's answered prayer. And then also, Father, we're looking forward to the future, Lord, not only for what we're going to do in the marriage retreat and Lord, also our Easter services, Lord, but also Bible school's coming. There's a lot of things coming, camps and things. We're super excited what you're going to do. You're going to move in our church mightily. So, Lord, we just pray you'll do that. But, Lord, today is our focus. Today is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So I pray that we'll praise you. Praise you from the heart and from the mind today, Lord God, and have our focus upon you. And I pray all that in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Well, I want to welcome you as well to Mulberry Springs Baptist Church if you're visiting with us today. We like to sweat. We don't dance and jump around and that kind of stuff, but we like fast songs at least to wake us up before we get into men's prayer and all that kind of stuff. So this is a familiar favorite that we enjoy here. So y'all jump in where you can.
These are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And these are the days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore. We are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion fills salvation. These are the days of Ezekiel. the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding the temple of grace. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as white in the world, and we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes.
We'll take it down just a little bit right here. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of jubilee, out of Zion till salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. Lift your voice. It's the year of jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes.
Terry Spencer, I am one of your deacons here at Mulberry, and I'd like to read Colossians 3:15. Let the peace that Christ gives you control your thinking, because you were all called together in one body to have peace. Always be thankful. I'd like to invite the men down for men's prayer. If you're a visitor with us and you don't want to come, that's okay. Men, bring your sons. Here at Mulberry, we believe the man is the spiritual leader of the family. And let us pray. Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We ask that you be with these men and their families. We lift them up to you, Lord, and pray that your will be done in their lives. We also ask that if there's anyone among us today that does not know you as their Lord and Savior, that today they come to know you. We praise this in Jesus' name. Amen. Everybody shake somebody's hand.
all of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint, let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for a groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus. There will be justice, all will be new, your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon.
Like a bride.
Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart.
Our God has risen from
because you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours.
Shout it out, behold.
Behold the Lamb, the story of redemption written on his hands. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours. We sing your praise. Endless hallelujahs to your holy name. Jesus, you will reign forevermore. The victory is yours.
He reigns forevermore.
The victory is yours.
King Jesus
reigns forevermore. The victory is yours.
Lord, we thank you that you paid the price. And I know we don't have to live there, because on that third day, what happened? That stone rolled away. And you stepped out of that tomb, and you're a living God. We don't have to pray to a grave. We pray to our living Savior. But it started there, with you taking my sin, my shame, the weight of the world, all the sin that had happened and all the sin that would come. You took it all. For one reason, not because we deserve it, not because we can earn it, because you love us. It's free. It's free. Lord, I just thank you for giving us the opportunity to be in your house today. I pray that if there's somebody here that doesn't know you, that doesn't know the freedom of that relationship with Jesus Christ, that they'd find it today. Lord, I know we've got those that are sick, those that are traveling. Lord, just want you to be with those, watch over them. Lord, intervene on their behalf, Lord. I just pray that whatever their need is, you meet it. For our children's leaders, as they get ready to go up, Lord, I pray that you just anoint them, watch over them, keep them safe. Be with Brother Danny as he comes and brings the word, as he finishes out this series. Lord, just that our hearts and minds would be open to hear from you today. I just thank you for all these people that were behind me, Lord, and just for their efforts and their gifts and their talents. Lord, there's so much that goes on behind the scenes to put together a one-hour service, prayer, practice, Lord, to just, and it's all for an audience of one, and that's you. And that's what I pray today, most of all, that everything that we do here brings glory and honor to you. So, Lord, just again, be with us during this time. Thank you so much for sending your son, Jesus. It's in his name that we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Children and children's workers, you are free to go.
Well, good morning, Mulberry. It's good to be with you today. I'm so thankful that you're here. And as we wrap up this sermon series entitled Images of the Church, and today we're going to talk about the Bride of Christ. So if you have your Bibles, go to turn to Ephesians chapter 5, 22 through 27. Images of the Church. Today's image is the Bride of Christ, Ephesians 5, 22 through 27. I normally don't like to drink water up here, but I took some sinus medicine. Woo! That just dries you out, boy. But so I think I'm ready to go now, ready for God to use me. As David said, an hour service, so it means that my time is locked in to 11. So we'll do it. But hey, I'm so glad, like I said, Ephesians 5, 22 through 33 is a story kind of husband and wives. Today we're going to kind of limit it to 22 through 27 as we talk about the Bride of Christ. I want to tell you, first of all, about a special day in my life other than the day of salvation. That was in 1989. This was a very special day. at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, November 30th, 1985, I stood at the altar of Woodlawn Baptist Church waiting for my bride, okay? Now, what happened next, I can only explain as a vision of loveliness, okay, and of beauty. Because at that moment, out walks Julie in her flowing white wedding dress, okay, with this beautiful, gorgeous black hair and a smile that glowed like the moon. It was phenomenal. She was a delight to behold. And I know for a fact that it took hours upon hours upon hours for her to get that prepared, to come forward and meet me at the altar that we might be married. So, let me tell you, that memory will be ingrained in my mind, in my conscience forever, because I never will forget her walking down that aisle to meet me, that we may be husband and wife for almost 39 years now. Amen? So, one day, though, there's going to be another marriage. And one day, it's going to be great, because one day, Jesus Christ is going to come again for his bride. It's going to be a great day. But until that day, the bride is still in a time of preparation for the coming of Jesus Christ, okay? And what a day that'll be when Jesus we all see. But guess what? We're not there yet, amen? He'll present us one day as a bride that's perfect, but we're not there yet. So that's why we need to study passages like this to learn about the bride of Jesus Christ. So if you are there, please stand with me as we honor the reading of God's holy, infallible, and inerrant word. It says in verse 22, "Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, his body, as is himself its Savior. Now, as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit in everything to their husbands. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he might present the church to himself in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish." Father God, I remember that day, Father, when I was married and how beautiful my bride looked when she came out, Lord God, of the back of the church, walked down that aisle to, Lord, exchange vows and rings with me and to be my wife. But Father, none of that can really touch what's going to happen one day, Father God, when your bride, the church, Lord God, is called up to be with Jesus Christ, the groom. And Father, it'll be a great, Lord, a great wedding, Father, the marriage supper of the Lamb, God. And Father, so I pray as we listen to this story today, as we just unpack what the Apostle Paul wrote, Father, we understand this has a lot to do with wives and husbands. But Father, the bottom it says it's a great mystery because he's speaking about Christ and his church in this passage. So Father, anoint me from on high. God, may I preach a word, Lord, that's hopeful and a word today that for anyone, Lord, who needs to hear it, God, they'll receive it. Father, I'm always asking you to let the word fall on good soil that'll produce fruit, Father God, for the future. And God, fruit for your kingdom. So, Lord, just hide me behind the cross. Lord, hide me in your word, God. May I decrease and you increase and may it be all about you today. Father, I just pray. I pray, Lord God, that, Lord, I will do well with this passage through my studies and such, God, and make it crystal clear what you're trying to say. For we are your bride and you are the groom. And I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. 2 points today. I want to talk about first the bride or church. We are. The bride or church, we are. As the husband is the head of the wife, Christ is the head of the church. The church has a headship, and it is Jesus Christ. In other words, Jesus Christ is the head of the church. That is his function. He's the leader, the head of his church. No pastor, no elder, no deacon, no teacher, no member will ever be the head of the church. This will not be. And as the head of the church, Jesus is both our leader and our life. Man, we owe Jesus to be our leader. We owe him everything. And in our life, life eternal, we owe him everything. So Paul distinguishes here when he says, you know, wives submit to your husband. Then he says, for the husband is the head of the wife. But then he goes a little further and goes, but Christ is the head of the church. So Paul distinguishes Christ as the head. A lot of people are confused about, well, maybe a bishop is, or maybe the pope is, or maybe a pastor is, or whoever is the leader. There is no leader, only Christ is the head. Now we're under shepherds, under Christ's leadership for the church, but Jesus is the head of the church. And any church that's got that wrong, that church will fail. It has to be under the headship of Jesus Christ. Jesus is not only the head of the church, he created the church. The church isn't some result of some human ingenuity. The church is not the result of some entrepreneur's vision. You know what? Let's start a business and we'll call it the church. And what we do is we have lots of people come in and we'll have them give money. We'll take that money. We'll do what we want with it. Or we'll build some kind of kingdom. No, only a spiritual kingdom can be built the way God wanted to build. Amen? This is God's kingdom. So it's none of us. It's him. The living Christ is the head of a living organism. This ain't no dead church, right? And when you identify Jesus as the head of the body, and that's what he is, and he has sovereign lordship and supreme authority over the church, and we acknowledge that, that is absolutely the church that we should be. Now, that's the church we are, because we do believe that Jesus is the head of the church, and we also believe he has sovereign rule over this church. No one else does. No one else does. And as Christians, I don't know about you, but it's both my delight and my duty to basically submit myself to the sovereign lordship of Jesus Christ. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess your mouth that Jesus is Lord, right? You believe God raised from the dead, you'll be saved. So he's Lord. So since the church is the place where Christ's lordship is on unique display, now how does that happen? Because we come to here and we worship him and we glorify him, then we go out there and we act like him, right? So this church right here is constantly, the lordship of Christ is constantly on display. Okay, this unique sense of lordship, because nothing else can match the church. Amen? There's not an organization ever been created that can match the church. Jesus' church. And now, because we come together to basically live in and walk in the lordship of Jesus Christ, I don't understand why anybody don't want to belong to the church. Right? Amen? I love the church. I love the church because God loves the church. Jesus loves the church. And our commitment to Jesus Christ requires us to commit our lives to the church. Now, church is twofold. There is church that when you get saved, you belong to the church. Jesus said upon this profession of faith of Peter, he would build his church. So when you receive Christ, you become a part of the church. But there's also the local church. And I believe Jesus not only loves the church, he loves the local church. For everybody should belong, yes, to the church of salvation when we get saved, but also the local church. Guess what else? I think everybody ought to honor their membership, the vows of membership. Hey, when I got married, that man asked me some specific questions. Will you honor her? You know, he says, basically, I'll just say the vows will be easier. I said, I, Danny, take thee, Julie, to be my lawful wedded wife, to having to hold you from this day forward, for better, for worse, for rich or poor, sickness and health. In the bad that may come our days, and the good that, the bad that may come our way, and the good that may, no, how about the good that comes our way, and the bad that may darken our days? Sometimes you get those messed up, amen? And be true to you in all things, according to God's holy ordinance, I pledge to you my faithfulness. I made a vow to her. Now, I'm not going to say that none of us are perfect in our vows, amen? We still struggle, but when it comes to our vow to membership of the church, we ought to take them just as seriously as we do our vows in marriage. We should. Now, what does a vow to a church mean? Well, for most churches, like our church, it means that you will live a godly life. That you'll be a no-doubter. That when you say, I belong. Matter of fact, this is a great illustration. We were, yesterday, we were on the road. We were going to Carthage to watch Nora play softball. And I had a man pull out that was going slow. Y'all know this. I mean, it is what it is. I'm not saying what you do right or wrong, but I mean, it doesn't matter. By the way, it's not illegal to pass people. Can I get an amen? It's not, y'all act like it's illegal to pass somebody. You don't pass them, no passes on, but if it's a pass on, you can pass them. Well, sure enough, they were going about 45. We're trying to get somewhere. And sure enough, we finally got down there towards Marshall where Dr. Parker lives, and it's kind of a long stretch way. You know, I got a V8, you know, so. I pulled out, I passed him. And Jesus said, you got a Mulberry sticker on the back of your truck. And I said, you put it there, not me, okay? That's right. I don't have no Mulberry sticker on my truck, okay? But she put it there. But I said, it's okay to pass. It's not wrong to pass, okay? But, you know, I want to live a life that people know this man is born again. He's a believer. There's something different about his life. And he is submitting, because this talks about submission here. That means to get in line. It's a military term, to get in line. I want to get in line because I am not the leader or the head. Jesus is. And I want my life to represent that when I'm in the public. Yesterday at the ball game, you know, the umpires make all kind of bad calls. Who's with me? Amen? 50% of the time, they're wrong. Every call, 50% of the time, they're wrong. It's always my 50, okay? So sometimes you got to remind them that wasn't a good call. That was a bad call. You know, stuff like that. So, but, you know, it's not in bad. You can't do bad stuff. You don't want to be thrown out of ball games. That's not a good representation of what Christ wants us to do. Amen? Like that. And I'm sure we're not going to do that kind of stuff. But I'm just saying, you want to be to living out your, I would call your, honor your vows of church membership, honor your vows of being a member of the church of Jesus. Amen? Of salvation. Not only that, participate and support worship and basically the work of the church. Amen? Submit to the leadership of the church. Love and serve the church. Make the church a priority. We make everything in the world a priority. Make church a priority because the headship of Christ shows up every time the doors is open. Let me tell you, one person who's not missing church is Christ. The Spirit is here. Praise God for that. Amen? What draws church to submit to the headship of Christ is, guess what? The Bible says his love. It says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Jesus loves the church. Listen to me. Jesus loves this church despite all our inadequacies, all our deficiencies, okay? All our imperfections. And let me tell you, you ain't got to look far to know that we got those. Amen? There is no perfect church. By the way, Jesus loved the church it really is, not some imaginary church. We're always looking for that imaginary church, right? You're the one that's got all perfect people. It's got all the pastors perfect. You know, he's got on skinny jeans and a t-shirt, you know, and, you know, he's got his hair combed back, and, you know, he's cool. It's all that. That ain't me. Amen? That's okay. Ain't nothing wrong with that. Ain't nothing wrong with that. I'm just saying that's what they are. I mean, I don't dress like that. I can wear skinny jeans, you know. You don't want to see it, but I can wear them. Amen? That's what I love. We're real. I want you to hear me. I believe this is a real church. And we got a lot of issues. Every church got some issues. We don't have the issues most churches have. I thank God for that. I mean, I'm not fighting battles a lot of churches have to fight. I'm so grateful that we got past all that stuff. Man, our church is just smooth. Amen. It's just a great place to be. God is here with us. The Spirit is leading us. The Spirit is permeating this place today. He's going to do a great work in just a moment. I believe that. But Jesus loves the real church. We need to be honest about the real church. It's got some issues. Amen, it does. He loved not only our church, he loved all the New Testament churches, all the churches with their problems, like the church at Corinth, who had so much disunity, the church at Ephesus that left their first love, and all the seven churches in Revelation. He loved all the churches, the one at Galatia, the one at Ephesus, the one at Philippi, Thessalonica. He loved those churches. How do you know he loved them? Because he gave his life for them. He loved us so much that he gave his life for us. That's why he tells us to love our wives like Christ, that he loved the church, that he gave himself up for her. So Jesus don't just say, I love you. He shows us he loves us. That cross back there behind me, it is a representation of his love. But God demonstrated his love towards us, and while we were sinners, Christ died for us. So he didn't just say he loved the church. He showed it. He stretched his hands wide open and said, I love you. I'm going to give my life for you. Listen to me. It's not just individual, but the church as a whole. Jesus proved his love for Mulberry Springs. I believe that with all my heart. I want you to hear me. Our church does not need your emotion, your sentiment, or your deep feelings. Our church needs your presence, your gifts, and your labor. Amen? That's what it needs. It needs you in the seat. And you in the service. Amen? I never joined the military, but I know people who do and who are in the military and who did. Let me tell you what. They didn't sleep in the first morning. Unless they want to be drug out by their hair, probably get out there. They lined up. My brother David, he would sleep till 1 o'clock in the afternoon. It's crazy. I've never seen anybody sleep as much as my brother David did. He just slept and slept and slept and slept. And basically go to bed at 10 and sleep till 11 or 12 the next day, just sleep. And if he came home one day and told mom and daddy, I joined the armed military. I thought, he won't make it. He'll be home in a week. You don't sleep till 1 o'clock in the military. You got in line. You show up. You do what they say. I'm not saying like military. We're military. We're not. That's not the point I'm making. The point is when you make a commitment to the military, you're going to keep that commitment. Yeah, amen. I'm thinking about joining a gym. I know you're thinking, why would he join a gym? I mean, how can you improve on that? But anyway, so I was just playing. But you know what? That's right. But you know what joining a gym takes? Membership. They want me to pay $90 for 3 months. I may not make it 3 months. Why am I going to pay? Just how about $30 for this month, okay? Some make you sign like 2-year contracts, you know, like Dish Network or something. You know what I'm saying? It's like that. I don't want to sign a 2-year contract. I may not make it 2 weeks. I don't know. You fall in love with the gym and then you fall out real quick, amen? But you've got to pay the price. They take it out of your checkbook, amen? They deduct it. Whether you work out and pump weights and sweat in there or not, it don't matter to them. They're getting the greenbacks, right? Well, listen to me. If we can make such commitments to worldly things, why can't we make a commitment to the bride, to be the bride of Christ? Amen? We can. Jesus did that. But let me tell you, Jesus not only loves the church, he's preparing the church for her work in the world. And look what the Bible says. He says he washes, he says in verse 26, that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. He not only loves the church, he prepares it. He washes the church in his word. And just as clear, fresh water cleanses our bodies, right? God's written word washes us clean deep down inside our souls. It purifies our thoughts. It scrubs our motives. It cleanses our conscience. As we absorb and obey His truth, the church is the great lavatory of life. This is where I get washed every week. In Sunday school, in church, and Wednesday nights, and Bible studies, and life groups at my home. I get washed in the Word. You got to bathe in the Word, amen, for it to clean you. If you don't know the Word, it's not going to clean you, right? You got to get in the Word for it to wash you. And Jesus washes with the word. When Jesus spoke the word, the words that Jesus spoke, if you'll get them in your life, it will clean you. Amen? It'll wash you. And by the way, the preaching of the gospel makes us clean. Because today somebody might come down this aisle, don't know Jesus Christ. Listen, if you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, today is your day. Amen, church? Come and let him wash you. Man, the gospel that Jesus died for you, was buried and resurrected. He paid your price. He took your place. If you'll come and put your faith in him, he will wash you. Listen, you may come dirty, but you're going to leave spotless and clean and without wrinkle. We'll see in just a minute. Come to Jesus. Jesus can do what a Tide Pod can't. Amen? For all you young people, that's not something you eat. That's something you will use clothes with. Just playing. Just playing. Some of y'all laugh like, what do y'all, I got that. Anyway, so he washes us with the word, cleanses our body. That's why we need church, folks. Now, I'm not saying you can't study the word at home. I hope you do. As a matter of fact, I hope you study it every day. But we need church where there are people who study the word all the time, that they might break it down the way that you can understand it so you can apply it to your life and be washed in the word. We need church. Now, I know some of y'all say, Brother Danny, you're the preacher. You got to be there. That's true. That is true. I'm not going to lie about you. I mean, it's not like I can just say, you know what, let's go fishing today, baby. You know, and y'all, then comes 10 o'clock and like, where's Brother Danny? He's fishing. Or golfing. Hey, it's so pretty outside. Let's go hit the links, baby. Ride me around. I know you don't play, but you can ride me around. I'll play. I can imagine how many Sundays that would last before I was looking for a job. Amen, first of all. Second of all, I don't have that option. But I can tell you this, because I've grown up in church pretty much all my life. I kind of got away from a while, but when you got a good mom and daddy who loves Jesus more than they love anything else, you got a wife who loves Jesus more than she loves you, then you'll definitely come back, amen? There's a time that I needed to be washed, and the Lord did that. But I can tell you this, man, I have fallen in love with church. I have. I'm going to lie to you. I have fallen in love with church. Man, it's just some place I like to be. Let me just plug in something we don't plug. If you don't come on Wednesday night, you're missing a blessing. Wednesday night is breakdown night, not break dance, break down, okay? We break down the scriptures on Wednesday night. We ask questions. We get into deep theological discussions, and we have a blast. Amen, we do. Now, I know everybody can't come on Wednesday night, that's fine, but if you'd like to, we'd love to have you. We have a great group of adults that meet in here, some young people as well, and just to be washed in the Word. By the way, I'm not washing you. Jesus is washing you with his word. Now, I know I'm not a perfect church, and as a person, you're not a perfect church. As a person, we're not a perfect church as a church either. But we are still the bride of Christ. And there'll be a day that he does present us as holy and blameless and spotless. You've never, let me tell you what you've never seen. You have never seen a bride come down the aisle in a dirty, filthy, nasty dress. Amen? No. Now, after the dance is over and all that over, she may get mud all over her dress and all that. You know, especially if you're outside wedding and it rained or something like that. But I've never been out here like, y'all all stand, all rise, and the bride walk out and go, ooh, God. That dress is filthy. Where'd you get that thing? Amen? Now, I've never done that. I promise you, I've done hundreds and hundreds of weddings. I have never looked at a bride and go, God. Matter of fact, I even make the guys look at me. Look at me. So when they turn around, they see her for the first time. Because I'm going to tell you what, I'm serious, like a 12-hour job, doing that stuff all makeup up and all that stuff. All. Amen, church? Come on, church. Amen? You've never done that before, ever. You've never taken 6 hours to get makeup on ever again. You never had 12 people helping you either. No one does that but a wedding. Guys, wait till like 5 minutes for the wait. Throw your suit on, man. Let's go. We got to go. But man, we've never seen. So listen to me. I want you to hear me now. Right now, there may be some things on our dress, because we're the bride. Maybe it's not as spotless as it needs to be. Maybe it's a little bit wrinkled. Maybe there's some blemishes in it. But let me tell you, one day there won't be. You listen to me. Listen, one day there won't be. Because look what the Bible says. The Bible tells us. It says that in verse 27, so that he might present the church himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle in any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So I want to talk about the bride or church we will be one day. Now, you will not be that if you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, because you're not in the church, and only the church will be in heaven. Only those who know Christ as their personal Lord and Savior will be with the Lord one day at the marriage supper of the Lamb. So, like I said a few minutes ago, the church is not a perfect place. It's imperfect, but this will always be the case while we're here. But at the end of the days, Christ will return, and he'll call his church up to meet him. And at that moment, the bride will be presented as a perfect church. Perfect church. Nothing will keep Jesus from presenting us as a perfect church. When he calls us up, we will be made perfect the instant that our body is resurrected from the grave and our disembodied spirit meets it, and boom, we will be perfect like he is perfect. Amen? The Bible says that day that Jesus will present his bride in all her splendor, a thing of glory. The church will be a thing of glory. It'll be so gorgeous and beautiful. By the way, there'll be no denominations that day. There will be no controversies that day. There'll be no divisions that day and no deacon meeting that day. Amen? On that day, we'll be standing at the altar with the groom, and we'll be presented to Jesus arrayed in splendor. By the way, the ray of splendor comes from the word that means she's cleansed. She's set apart unto God. And Jesus is going to present himself, the Bible said, a radiant church. Amen? A radiant church, all right, that is beautiful to himself. And such splendor, she'll carry this splendor into eternity with her and with us as a church. He will present the bride without stain. Now listen to me. The church is positionally clean right now. You got to understand this. It is positionally clean in Christ. I am washed clean. But experientially, I will be in heaven clean. Positionally, I am in Christ, so I'm clean. But one day in heaven, I will have no spot or wrinkle with me or you or our church because of the fact that he is, for sure now, we are in the presence of the Lord experientially. Now, by the way, the Bible says he'll also remove spot and wrinkle. Now, those are words that come from the Old Testament sacrificial system. Remember, the lamb had to be sacrificed without blemish or without spot. In other words, there'll be no defects in Jesus' saving work. There's inner beauty to the salvation. By the way, we're being worked on inside out, not outside in. Amen? Christ ain't concerned about making you beautiful on the outside, but beautiful on the inside. I can change my outside looks, and I'm doing that. I'm going through the process of getting ready for summer. Come on, who's checking with me? Amen? Julie said that because I've had some issues with my skin, Julie said, you got to get a spray tan this year. I know somebody in our church. First of all, I don't know. I love y'all, but it was just, I don't know about all that. But anyway, She's just looking out for her husband, amen, because that's what she does. But this spot or wrinkle means that we're impure. But hey, when Jesus presents his church, then one day, I guarantee there'll be no spot or wrinkle upon us. Also, not only that, but the wrinkle speaks to the word of age. It's like an older person. I get wrinkles, you get wrinkles. Listen to me. There's a sign of age for sure as we age. But the church on earth today has many spots and wrinkles. But positionally, I have no spot and no wrinkle because I'm in Christ. One day I'll have no spot or no wrinkle or nothing else on my body that's impure. The Bible says Jesus also sets his bride apart as holy, right? Holy and without blemish. The word holy there means to be set apart. We are that way. No one can find fault with Jesus' bride. No one can find fault with Jesus' bride. The idea of without blemish means unblameable or faultless. Now, I don't know, you to probably look at yourself that way, but listen, in Christ, we are all these things. But one day, I will be made perfect, and our church will be made perfect in Christ on that great day. That's a special day, amen? Because, you know, your wedding was a special day. I don't care if you got married. I think mom and daddy got married at the Justice of the Peace office. No, I mean, I think they did. Anyway, by Brother Maul, married my mom and dad, my pastor. Growing up, Brother Sistrunk married me and Julie and married Don and Vince and married some of our family. Me and Julie were married in the church. And I always remember that day. It's a special day. It's a getting ready day. There's a lot of details that go into that day. And it was beautiful. And I'll never forget it. I also remember they rubbed shaving cream all in my hair. Ray and all them did when I was leaving. So we had to go straight and wash my hair. Because y'all know my hair. But anyway. But I'll never forget how beautiful that day was. It was a beautiful day. Not only does the bride look good, the groom looks pretty good too. Amen? Whatever. So think about that day. I want to read you about that day. Okay? Listen to me. Revelation 19, verse 8. Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, hallelujah. For the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him the glory. For the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his bride has made herself ready. It was granted to her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. One day it's going to happen, folks. Amen? It's going to be a great wedding in heaven. I believe it to be. I mean, you can disagree, and that's fine. It's really not a matter of salvation, but I believe that to be the rapture, and I believe we're going to have a great wedding in heaven, and Jesus will present his church in heaven. It'll be so great. I'm looking forward to it, but until that time, listen to me. Listen to me. He ain't through with us yet. He's still working on us. And even though he's setting us aside as a strikingly beautiful bride, and one day it's going to be a great wedding, it's going to be beautiful. But let me tell you what is true of the church collective is also true of the church individually. Because the reality is that in a family where you're the only one saved, you are the church. And one day you will be presented with the church. So I want you to know, not only individually, but collectively and individually, we're also a part of the church that we presented. Because listen, Mulberry Springs Baptist Church will not stand before the Lord. Individuals of Mulberry Springs Baptist Church will stand before the Lord as the church. You know why? Jesus holds a special love for his church. And I believe all of us, listen to me, I don't want to get on you. I'm not trying to do that. But guys, you got to have a special place in your heart for the church. This is the body of Christ, right? We talked about that. We're basically members of the household of God. We're family, amen? And Jesus holds a special love for his family. And I'm grateful for that. And I'm grateful that he loves Mulberry Springs Baptist Church so much that he's putting his blessing upon us, amen? He's got great things for our future. I believe that. He loves Mulberry Springs Baptist Church. And he wants to see Mulberry Springs Baptist Church do well. But he also wants to see the individual members of Mulberry Springs Baptist Church commit to him. That's what it takes to do well. An uncommitted marriage will not last long. Can I just say amen? Me and Julie, when I said I do and I gave her a ring, and she gave me a ring, he said, you may kiss your beautiful bride, and I kissed her right there. We locked lips right there at the pulpit. Amen? And he said, that's enough. But anyway, he said, hey, we walked away. Now, if I'd have walked away to the right and she'd walked away to the left, we'd never seen each other again. Then we really wouldn't have been a marriage. So since Jesus is the groom and we're the bride, I think we need to commit ourselves to the groom. Because the groom has committed fully and completely and utterly everything to the bride. He gave it all. Let's not be the church that just gives some. Let's also reciprocate that love by loving him and his church. For we are the bride of Jesus Christ. A great wedding will take place. I pray that you'll be in that wedding. I pray that you'll be a part of that wedding. If you're not, today you can change the trajectory of your life. You can change the place that you're about to end up. You can know Jesus and put your faith in him, trust him, and be saved today, and your life will be forever changed. Maybe today that you join a church, we'd love to have you come be a part of a fellowship that's about to exit this building, go to the new building pretty soon, 4 or 5 months, and it's going to just go crazy over there. So we're super excited about what God's going to do and such. Or maybe you're here today and you need to dedicate your life, because the truth is, if I could just be real honest, this is one of them sermons that when I preach it, I just feel like the whole altar ought to be filled with people saying, hey, I just need a new commitment to you, Jesus Christ, and your church. Amen? I just want to recommit myself to doing what I need to do, because you can do everything in the world, but the church is just as important, more important than all those other things. And I'm not talking about just the attendance of the church. I'm talking about being the church wherever you go. Maybe today you just need to rededicate your life because of sin, whatever it may be. I believe the Lord has something for the church today, not just lost people. So I pray that you'll be prepared for that day. So would you stand with me this morning as we pray? Heavenly Father, as I'm mindful of the Apostle Paul writing this passage, outlining holy living within the confines of marriage between a husband and wife. In the next chapter, Father, he skips down to children and parents. But I love where it says in that passage that it's a mystery. It's not just husband and wives, it's a mystery, because the mystery is the fact that Jesus, you are the groom, and we're the bride. And one day, we're going to be married. You're going to come get us. You're going to take your bride to be with you forever in eternity. I'm grateful for that. And I'm grateful that could happen today. And Lord, I pray we're a church that's looking, that's anticipating, that's living a life that says, I'm ready. If Christ came today, he could find me watching and waiting and working for the kingdom. And I pray for that, Lord. I pray we'll be a bride that's prepared and ready. We'll allow Jesus to wash us with the word, to cleanse us, and remove the spots and the wrinkles from us as we present ourselves to the church under the preaching of the holy word every week. And be committed to a church somewhere, Father. So God, today, whatever the invitation may be, I don't know what it is. It's always your invitation, not mine. I'm not trying to, Lord God, pull anybody, Lord. The Spirit does that, not me. I'm not trying to force anybody. Lord, I just want the Spirit to move in this invitation. Whatever it is you want to do, Father, be done for your glory and your honor and our good. So, Father, thank you for the time that I've had to preach the bride of Christ. And thank you. Thank you, Jesus, that without a shadow of a doubt, you're coming back. And we're going to be with you. Father, may we be mindful of those things. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on right now, make that decision. ladies at the altar keep praying and just what they need. Terry, you'll come forward.
It ain't on, is it? No, here we go. This is just a special day in Mulberry Springs. This sermon you heard started 18 years of ministry here today. And we just wanted to tell Brother Danny and Miss Julie thank you. And just wanted to recognize you.
Thank you.
That's great.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the service today. Thank you so much for Brother Danny and all his years he served here. What a blessing it has been for him and Miss Julie and their family to be here with us, Lord. And we pray that they will continue to be with us for many years to come. Lord, just bless the offering that's about to be taken. Be with us as we all go home today and bring us back on Wednesday. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.